I would like to share with you my research work, being a pioneer in the field of ancient knowledge system of Vastu, and the present researches being done under the name of geobiology, and how we have been able to bring the two systems working together into a science, into a knowledge system, which we are now able to impart to other people around the world.
The year 627, a lone 28-year-old monk from China sets on a spiritual quest all the way to India. He treks his way across 34 kingdoms, recording his experiences, arrives at Nalanda, the leading center of Buddhist learning in India, and studies Buddhist philosophy under the tutelage of the grand old guru Shilabhadra. Shunning fame and glory, he returns home after 19 years of pilgrimage with 657 sacred texts and a personal diary that describes life at Nalanda. Completely at ease with the Chinese and Sanskrit language, he translates 47 scriptures, totaling 1,335 volumes of wisdom, and gets his name imprinted in history as Xuanzang. One wonders what was so special about those ancient texts from India that he dedicated an entire lifetime to understanding and translating them. Ancient India had highly formalized methods of Vedic learning through well-established large teaching institutions such as Takshila, Nalanda and Vikramashila, recognized as India's early universities. Thousands of students from across the world came to specialize in over 64 different fields of study like Vedas, grammar, philosophy, astrology, Ayurveda, agriculture, surgery, politics, archery, warfare, astronomy, commerce, music, dance, futurology, and many more. Each of these was regarded a shastra or system of knowledge and were vehicles of spiritual expressions that helped refine and uplift the values and sentiments of human society. Mastering as many of the 64 arts was considered important in the development of a cultured individual. Thanks to the brief sojourn of Lord Macaulay during the colonial rule, the ancient Indian Gurukul system of education was eradicated. As Lord Macaulay addressed the British Parliament, he said,
"I have travelled across the length and breadth of India, and I have not seen one person who is a beggar, who is a thief. Such wealth I have seen in this country, such high moral values, people of such calibre, that I do not think we would ever conquer this country unless we break the very backbone of this nation, which is her spiritual and cultural heritage. Therefore, I propose that we replace her old and ancient education system, her culture. For if the Indians think that all that is foreign in English is good and greater than their own, they will lose their self-esteem, their native culture, and they will become what we want them to be, a truly dominated nation.
And so came into force an education system that focused on developing one form of intelligence. Even as the ancient Indian way of developing an individual in multiple forms of intelligence by learning as many of the 64 arts was completely lost. Perhaps the Indian mind has evolved in a different direction.
I don't believe in all this cultural stuff. Why should I spend so many years learning martial arts? It's not going to help me in my profession. I'm not going to become any more successful. Self-defense? Probably. But isn't it easier if I just carry a pepper spray or carry a knife? Why would I waste so many years and all my energy in learning an art form that is probably not going to help me in any way?
There is much more to an art form than the mere techniques that meet the eye. For example, martial arts is one of the 64 arts. Here, we witness students learning Kalaripayattu, the Kerala form of martial arts. It not only helps exercise your body, it keeps you mentally alert, calms you emotionally, inculcates a never give up attitude, and makes you relentlessly strive towards perfection. To top it all this becomes a part of your character permanently. For centuries, the Indian collective consciousness has focused on striving towards reaching a state of being where the eternal spirit manifests in the individual's mental realm and activities. The Indian social system, philosophy, arts, culture, and religion all revolve around this conception and are considered to be instruments that aid in the expression of the eternal spirit embedded in each one of us. It was in an earnest attempt to achieve this that the Indian pursued 64 traditional art forms. In 1983, a Harvard professor, Howard Gardner, propounded a theory that human beings function with multiple intelligence instead of one. The theory had a profound impact on the educational system in the West, reiterating what the ancient Indian texts have prescribed centuries ago. The ancients were able to achieve these objectives as one was relaxed and free to fiddle and wonder at his surroundings, paving the way for the free flow of inquisitive questioning and intuitive learning.
When I was very young, at the age of 16, I got a very interesting book in my hand from a friend. It was called The Psychic Discoveries Behind the Iron Curtain.
It opened up a whole new field of interest for me, and I began experimenting with pyramids.
Unbelievable! How did food grains remain fresh inside the pyramid? I mean, even the corpses, they didn't decay, they were mummified, there was no smell whatsoever. I mean, how did the Egyptians figure this all out such a long time ago?
Centuries after they were built, one still wonders at how these glorious structures were built with bare hands and practically no technology.
what it showed in that book was that a lot of research was being done in Russia and East European countries. And they found that when things are kept in the pyramid at one-third the height of the pyramid, with respect to the total height, at that one-third the height, nothing gets spoiled. If you keep food and all, it will not decay, it will get mummified. It's like hard like stone. So what happens is that there are four factors which play into it. The form of the pyramid, which is a triangular with a square base. The second, its proportions, especially the angle, which is about 51 to 52 degrees. Third is the orientation of the pyramid, which should be perfectly aligned to east-west direction, north-south, east cardinal directions. And lastly, the material from which it is made. So it should not be any metal. It should be as much as possible natural material, wood, stone, etc. So with these four factors working into it, there is a kind of a concentration of energy which takes place at one-third the height of the pyramid. And there, when you keep food, it doesn't get spoiled. Now, the question which arose in my mind is that the same thing is what we do in architecture, in every building. Form, proportion, orientation, materials. So what kind of energy is there in the building, and is there a method of knowing how to find out the effect of it, whether it's positive, whether it's negative, whether it's harmful, and whether we can work with it and ameliorate.
Could buildings really affect one's health and well-being? Perhaps there is more to the rituals our ancestors performed. The genius of our ancients was in converting deep scientific knowledge into simple art forms for all people to follow. For centuries, the people of Vrindavan relate with the child who adorns the role of Krishna in the dance Rasleela as the Lord himself. The whole act of getting ready and performing is done with so much devotion, reiterating the ancient belief system that work is worship. Learning an art form like dancing makes not just your dance, but makes you graceful, focused, integrates a sense of multiplicity, and enables you to grow spiritually, holding on to the immortal rhythms. Pursuing the arts and developing oneself in multiple skills has an effect on the physical, mental, emotional, and psychic realm.
In one of my trips to Europe, especially to France in 1983, during the Festival of India, I was asked to make a presentation on my research work. So after my presentation, there was a young group of architects who came to see me. And they said they were very interested in my work from the point of view of geobiology. And that's the first time when I heard the word geobiology, and I asked them what it was all about. And they explained to me that this was a research started by medical doctors. Basically, that when they visited patients at home, they found that there were certain places, certain homes where whoever came and stayed developed the same health problem as the predecessors. And this they called as the sick building syndrome. What they were trying to understand is, what is it in the building which causes health problems in our body, and what is it in the body that gets affected, and why does it get affected, and is there a way by which this can be prevented? So the research started, and for the last 50 years this has been going on. And what they were able to understand is that nature of the radiations that exist in a building, which are all in the ranges of gigahertz. And the same way the cells of the body vibrate in that range. What they were not able to understand is, what is it in the body that gets affected? Why does it get affected? And is there any way of preventing it from being affected? And I found that all our ancient knowledge systems which existed in the Vedas, the Upanishads, etc., they speak of the various aspects of our human body. But how does it work in the human body was not clear to anyone and is not clearly expressed anywhere.
So do you mean to say the environment that we live in also has an effect on the energy system of our body?
A multitude of reactions take place in the millions of cells in our body as they respond to a changing environment. Though man inherits certain properties through genes, his environment, including his geographical environment, like which part of the globe he resides in, the natural landscapes around him like mountains, rivers, forests, and the man-made structures like his house and place of work, where he spends majority of his time, plays a vital role in shaping him.
In the beginning, when I started working on the subtle energies of the human body, I was not getting very further into the subject until one night I had a very, very powerful experience in which I lived various aspects of how these energies exist in the body, how they get affected, what are the factors that impact us, how to maintain the alignment, etc. In order to able to express this powerful experience, it took me 33 years of research into every aspect of it, doing it very systematically, very methodically, very scientifically, with the help of various equipments, with the help of various instruments. And today we are in a position to be able to demonstrate, to show, to explain to people how these energies work, how they can be rectified, how they can be corrected. And you can see the effect of it in terms of health, wealth, prosperity, growth, etc.
With the aim of bringing the sacred back into our lives, Dr. Prabhat Podar and Ila Podar have been doing active research in the field of geobiology and architecture for more than 3 decades.
I would like to share here the nature of the work we are doing with regard to one of the ancient texts. This is called Sakaladhikari. The first part of the text and the translation work is to convert the palm leaves text, which is written in a script called Granthi, which is the forerunner of the Tamil script, into Sanskrit and into other Indian vernacular languages. The second part of it is that when we are doing the translation and the meaning of the words, it is very important that we involve people from the tradition, because the way they interpret the text is more important than just translating the text from the whatever language into Sanskrit or from Sanskrit to some other vernacular language. For example, if we take the word Kamal, I would translate it as lotus. Similarly, if the word Pankaj comes, I would again translate it as lotus. But for the people in the traditional field, when the word Kamal comes, it means an upward-facing lotus. And that is what is used normally for showing the divinities and all standing on the lotus. When the word Pankaj comes, it means a downward facing lotus. And therefore, these lotuses are carved on the beams of the temples and structures. The second part of it is when we have done the translation work to convert the whole thing into graphics. Because that's the language that we understand today, and that's the language which every child and every person is familiar with, especially with the computer systems. The idea of this graphics is to prepare the next phase of the work, which is the conversion from graphics to practical molding, casting, and converting the graphics into actual sculptures. Now imagine this ancient text of Sakaladhikari has 550 shlokas. And each one of them has to be done in the same way. Similarly, we have to do it for all the 64 arts that we have. And there are thousands of them.
Thanks to Dr. Prabhat Podar and Akash Education and Research Trust, unraveling our ancient texts have begun, paving the way for more to be done in this direction.